Hello, everyone. My name is Lionel Sanner from Pembroke Publishers, and it's great to have you join us today for our webinar. We have three sessions with three different speakers, about 15 minutes each, and then a few minutes for questions. So the format for today is each of our speakers will talk for around 10 to 15 minutes, and then we'll have a few minutes for questions. Please feel free to put your questions into the chat and I will monitor that and then at the end bring those questions forward to the presenters. This session is being recorded and you will get an email tomorrow with a link to that recording and any of the handouts that have come out today. So look for that and please feel free to share that with your colleagues because I know well, this year's probably always been busy as we get near the holiday season. It's especially a busy time, and so not everyone can join. So it's great to get the word out as well. So with that, I'd like to get started and introduce our first presenter, Heather Hollis. Heather is a teacher with more than 20 years of experience. She earned her bachelor degree from the University of New Brunswick and a master's degree in literacy from Mount St. Vincent University. So I guess I didn't ask you this before, but an East Coast East Coaster from beginning to end based on education and where you are now. She's currently working at the Learning Center as a teacher in the Hammonds Plains, Nova Scotia. And she also, if you don't know Heather, she has a humorous blog called The Suburban Princess Teacher. And I suspect that it would strike a nerve with teachers from all around the world. I do know that this has had over more than 250,000 views of the blog. I also know, having taken a look at it, that if you're looking for some humor, but also some stress reduction, I do like the rants, Heather, and I didn't mention that to you before, but that's a great section. So if you've got to start somewhere on her blog, I highly recommend the rants and especially the budget one on teachers' budgets and what goes with that. So yeah. Heather, it's great to have you here. Thanks for joining us. And I'll pass the virtual mic over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Lionel. Yes, welcome everyone to our webinar on joyful teaching and learning in difficult times. And I should just add that I haven't been working in the Learning Center for a while now. I'm teaching at Mount St. Vincent University in Halifax, and it's basically all still teaching. So I'm going to just discuss that here as we go through the slides. But in my opinion, teaching is teaching is teaching. So I started my presentation by asking sort of who is this presentation for? And I know that you're all coming to us from different backgrounds and different schools and different situations. So I've really prepared this presentation for teachers of students of all grade levels. Personally, I've taught children as young as four who have ants in their pants, all the way up to a 60-year-old nun who was learning English as a second language. And since September, I've been teaching online to second-year students in the education program. And this is a course I've taught for a couple of years in person. So I had to change everything about the way I teach in order to adapt to online teaching. And so what I've learned over the past number of years that I've been teaching, which is probably 25 now, is that no matter who our students are, what we need to do is engage them in the learning process before any learning takes place. And that's for kids as young as four or adults as old as who are still learning, which is all of us. All right. So whether we're teaching in person or online, the process is the same. So we need to start by hooking our students somehow so that they get engaged. And then once we have their attention, then we can start teaching. So you want to start with engagement before you move into instruction, before you get your students working on their own, before you get into a discussion. You've got to get their attention. So here's an activity you can do either online or in person, and it's called What Do You Mean? And there's probably 100 of these online. I just Googled a couple of them and came up with this one here. They have cats and dogs. They have Baby Yoda. They have all the characters from The Office. They have the characters from SpongeBob. So depending on your age group and your class, you can pick a meme that's going to suit your group. So what I'd like to do is just try it out here with everybody, just so you can see how it works. So the way I would introduce this is to say, how are you doing today on a scale of 1 to 9 in dog scale? Which dog are you most relating to at this moment? So I've already picked dog number 7 because whenever I wear these little headphones, I feel like I'm just I'm getting ready to record my next album. So this is a great way to start your class, to take attendance. This is what I did with my BED students sometimes. Just get them to punch in the number that they relate to. And then you sort of get an idea of how people are feeling without making them feel like you're psychoanalyzing them and getting into a deep conversation about their feelings right off the bat. You know, how are you feeling? And if all of your people pick the sad dog, if everybody picks dog number 8, you know, maybe you need to have a conversation about mood at that time. So this presentation basically follows the same pattern that I have outlined in my book, which is called Teaching with Humor, Compassion, and Conviction. And in the book, I start with engagement, and then I move into humor, then compassion and conviction. And that's how I've laid out this presentation as well. So if you're looking for a quick way to get your students' attention and get them engaged with the class, you may want to start with some sort of movement activity, like go noodle. So we've got like a little 30-second clip lined up here. And so I just encourage you to listen and clap along if you want, have a little dance in your chair, and I'll see you in about 30 seconds.
We're gonna get funky, 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 funky. Everybody clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap your hands. All right, now, we're gonna do the basic step. To the left. Take it back now, y'all. One hop this time. Right foot, let's stomp. Left foot, let's stomp. Cha-cha, real smooth. Turn it out.
Okay, welcome back. Did anybody dance along in their chair other than me? So these movement activities, go noodle, anything like that, they get your kids up and moving. And if you were to do this one, especially the funky funky, if you did this one every day for a week or two, you'd probably have your whole class dancing in unison. Everybody would learn the cha-cha slide. So that's great. Once you do that, you've got some engagement. So you settle them down and you get into work. So one of the ways that I find to engage our students as well in learning, both online and in person, is through the use of humor. And I was just looking at Erica's comment about how she's dancing in her flannel PJs. I love it. So I've been teaching the adult BED students, like I mentioned before, and this has been one of the best ways that I can get their attention and get them interested in some of the material that may be a little drier than what they want to focus on at the time. So how can we inject some humor into English language arts? Because that's sort of the area that I'm interested in. So I love this little meme of the granny where she says, you know, who says teaching is stressful? I'm 39 and I feel great. You can throw those up with your PowerPoints, you know, get a little laugh out of them, then bring their attention over to the actual information that you're trying to share. So you can incorporate humor in your classroom through funny read alouds, stocking your library with funny books, put some joke books in there, especially the boys, they love to share those back and forth with each other. Funny videos that may add a little bit of levity to your classroom. Because I know in this time, it's very challenging. People are nervous and people are scared. Some of your kids might be really anxious. Anything you can do to lighten that mood is really good. So I've included a little clip of a video in here, and it's a way to inject some humor into a grammar lesson. And as we all know, grammar lessons are hilarious most of the time. Not really. So anything you can do to spice them up is always good. So this one here is for teaching contractions for grade twos. Check it out.
I am thinking about cats. I'm thinking about cats.
So that little video is only 3 minutes long. I used it with my BED students, and a lot of them thought that this would be a great one to do with their class. All I do is Google them. It's, you know, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. There's so much out there right now. If you just type in funny videos about, and then put in the name of the thing you're looking for, chances are you can find a cute short video about it. So I've included here a handout, which Lionel was going to share with you so that you can take it with you. And this is from my book as well. And it basically is an activity that is one of those I do, we do, then you do kind of activities. So you start by introducing this brainstorming sheet and you read the questions to them. The teacher may want to share a funny story of her own. And then by this time, you're probably going to have a lot of hands in the air waving around if you're teaching in the younger grades, because they're all going to want to share their funny story. This is when you flip them into a pair share situation. And if you're working online, maybe if you have access to breakout rooms, put them into paired breakout rooms and get them to share their stories with each other. Then you come back as a full group, share as a full group all your funny stories, fill in the chart, and then ask your students to pick maybe one of those things off the chart to write a longer story about. So that's a way you can get them to start thinking about using humor in their writing, which may encourage some of them to write a little bit more than they might otherwise do. So the next section is on compassion. And as we all know, we could all use a little more compassion these days. So one of the things we often hear in this time is that we're all in the same boat when it comes to COVID-19. And honestly, that's not exactly true. We may all be in the same storm, but we're not all in the same boat. As you know, some of our students have more access to technology. They may have a stronger internet connection. They may have more attentive parental support than some of your other students. Even teaching adults this term, I found that some of my students were better able to cope with the strains of the pandemic than others. So this is a perfect time to remember that fair isn't always equal. Some of our students may need more support than others, and they may need extensions for work, extra help, reduced workloads. So getting to know our students and their situations is vital every year, but never more so than this year that we're in right now. So how can we help them? Well, one of the best ways we can help our students is to let them help others. When we allow our students to develop their own sense of compassion and their own ability to help, while at the same time improving their reading and writing skills, we've got ourselves a real win-win on our hands. So one of the best things we can do is give them the opportunity to do something for somebody else. And this may give them a sense of control over something in their lives at a time when they have very little control over anything. So, you know, their hockey might have been canceled. They may not be able to go to brownies anymore. They may not be able to go to their friend's house. But if you can say to them, hey, you know what? Your story is really good. Let's get you to polish that up. We're going to do some editing and then we're going to publish it. And we're going to share it with some residents in a senior complex who are really lonely right now. And I bet they'd love to read your story. You're going to get a lot of buy-in, I think, from your kids, because most kids are very generous and kind. And if they're given the opportunity, they will show you that. So the next little thing I wanted to do with you was share with you a book that I've used for years now, written by children's author Sherry Fitch. And this book is for teachers, and it's basically a it's almost like a collection of lesson plans that you can do with your students. And they follow the same pattern every time. You start with a short breathing activity. You move into a very simple yoga pose. And then you give them some writing exercises that they can do. And so I've used this with my students over the years. And the writing that they produce is usually fantastic because you've gotten them to calm down, stretch it out, and then think about what they're going to write, and then expand upon it. So just to give you an idea of what it sounds like, she starts with basically explaining how to breathe. So she suggests, this is how she outlines it. Always breathe in and out through your nose. Place your hand close to, but not on your belly near your navel. So if you want to do that, nobody can see you. You can just put your hand right on your belly near your navel. When you inhale, push your belly towards your hand. And when you exhale, pull your belly in. Imagine your navel touching your spine. Do this three times. So the first time your kids will probably laugh. But then they start to calm down, and being able to breathe deeply in and out sort of settles them. Then you do the stretch. So for this one, it's a mountain pose, and she outlines exactly how to do that. Then she says, okay, take out your pen. This is Sherry instructing the teachers to tell their students, take out your pen and make a list of the five most important things in your life. So the kids just have to write a list. There's nothing hard about that. Most of them can do that. So they make a list of the five most important things in their life. Once you see that everybody's done, then you say to them, okay, now you're going to make another list. Pretend you're 5 years old. Make a list of the five most important things in your life. When they're done, pretend you're 88. List the five most important things. Then pretend you're a dog. This is always their favorite. List the five most important things in your life. Then you say to them, now look at all the lists together. Are there any things they have in common? Are there any things that are different? Discuss. Then you move into the writing part of it and you say, okay, pick one of those things from your list. And I want you to write for 5 minutes. That's it, about that one thing. So it's all free writing. Then you stop, ask them if they'd like to share what they've written. If not, there's another activity they can move on to, or you can move on to something else within your writer's workshop. So I highly recommend this book. Lionel's put it up there, but it's a fantastic book. And it's just from a teacher time perspective, it's fantastic because you can literally take out two pages of this book, photocopy it, put it on your desk, and you've got your lesson plan for a sub for the next day if for some reason you weren't able to be there. So it's great. Final thing I wanted to talk about was conviction. So how do we inspire our children to live by the strength of their convictions? So we need to allow our students to know that it's okay for them to have their own opinions and to argue for what they feel is right. And one of the best ways we can do that is through persuasive writing. So children as young as grade primary can discuss or draw their opinion, their preferences, what they like. And then as they move up through the grades, they can elaborate on those through their writing and through their speech. So this involves critical literacy skills that can be continued throughout their school years. And allowing them to have that conviction gives them some strength that they may need to overcome some challenges that they may face later in their lives. So that's just a little outline of a child doing some persuasive writing. Nice little bit of working away there. So I want to end by thanking you, all of you teachers who are joined in here today for everything that you do. I know you must be exhausted from teaching all day in the midst of a pandemic, all the while trying to support your students and their families. I ask you to please take care of yourselves. And I don't just want you to take care of yourself so that you can be a good teacher. I want you to do it for you because you're worth it. So thank you for joining us this evening. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the presentations.
Heather, that was great. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. It's nice to listen to that. As you were talking, there were sort of three themes, if I can call them that, that came out. And I'm just looking at my notes here. But, you know, you sort of talked a little bit about humor, compassion, and conviction. And you also talked a lot about teachers and your belief in what they're doing. And I think we got it. Most of us got into teaching. We probably had something with compassion and conviction. But humor is kind of, you know, that takes a while to build into your repertoire as a teacher. Now that this has all gone online, has that been a challenge, or does it just kind of naturally flow your style, you know, with the humor? Because I know as soon as the video started, I mean, you were totally animated, right? I don't know if I could do that, right? So, but you could see it. It was like, okay, it becomes infectious. So I don't know if you have any thoughts on that. Is kind of a closing comment, or
I was just gonna. I'm not sure. I think that one of the things I learned along the way was that no matter how cool I thought I was, I'm not cool, because the kids always think of you as being old, even when you're young. Yeah. And so once I got over that desire to impress them, I just do your own thing. And they may say, that's my goofy teacher. But you know what? Some of them will be dancing along in their chairs if I'm dancing in mine. And, you know, that kind of gets them going. So.
And I think they kind of like you to be goofy too, right? Yes. They love you for it, even though they might never say it. That's great. Good. Well, thank you very much. We'll move on to our next speaker now. Okay. Well, now we'll move on to our second presenter. It's my pleasure to introduce Amanda Yuill to you. Amanda has extensive experience, including teaching in both public and private schools in Canada and Japan. And if this was the regular world pre-COVID and we were all at a conference, we'd probably all be going for a drink after Amanda, listening to all the stories of what it's like to teach in Japan, because I suspect that there are many stories that could be brought forward from your adventures. Also, for those of you that don't know Amanda, she's a teacher of primary grades, music, physical education, dance, drama, and English as a second language. And when I was talking with my colleagues at Pembroke, they also said that she's passionate about substitute teaching as a way to explore all aspects of education. And I think I can say in my almost 30 years of being in this field, I've never heard anyone identify substitute teaching as being passionate about. And so I tip my hat to you immediately for that. And I think we should, you know, when we're sick, we're really happy to have a substitute teacher, but we're also thankful when we have that job and are not on that side. So you have my admiration right from the very start, just with that alone. So with that, I'll pass the virtual mic back over to you and let you get started.
So, konnichiwa. Watashi no namae wa Amanda desu. Dozo yoroshiku onegai shimasu. Moshi nihon jun ga koku ni itara, gomenasai ne. Watashi no nihongo wa hata desu ga, ganbarimasu. Kyō watashi wa eigo ga naratte imasu seito tachi o hanashitai. Sono seito tachi wa Kanada ni kuru to, hontō ni zenzen eigo ga wakaranai. De, zutto 8 jikan gakko de eigo に聞きます。それは大変ね。で、私たちはどうしよう。その生徒たちは、自分の言葉で話すの時は大丈夫ですか？大丈夫ではないですか？私たちはどうしよう。その生徒たちは、友達と話します。自分の言葉で話します。英語だけ話します。どうしよう。それは、本当に問題でしょう。ありがとうございます。Okay, so you might be wondering if I went a little crazy. I did not. And you probably guessed that was Japanese. It is Japanese. And what I want to do today is give us a bit of experience of what our students are experiencing. And so this experience was our English language learners, right? That was 1 minute of Japanese. And when I was in teachers college, they taught us, you know, when you have English language learners, they should not speak in their own language. Nobody should have helped them. It should be English all the time. And then I went and lived in Japan for 7 years. And can I tell you, I was so glad people spoke to me in English during the day. I didn't know what was going on. And I made so many mistakes. Like, I remember I tried to tell this lady that it was dark on a bus, but by mistake, I told her that she was dirty. You know, or my boss, his name was Mr. Abe, but by mistake, I called him Mr. AB, which means Mr. Shrimp. And he was really short. Like, they're making mistakes too. And we're laughing and they don't know why we're laughing. And so I think sort of building on what Heather was saying about compassion, when I came back from Japan, it changed the way I taught English language learners. I really had quite a bit more compassion. 8 hours or 6 hours a day listening to a language you don't know while you have culture shock and you're sad missing your friends. Nowadays, when they come, if there's somebody in the class who can translate for them, I just let them translate. Okay, I am trying to go to the, there we are. Okay, so the next sort of student I want to talk about is students who have behavioral challenges. So again, like in teacher's college, I was sort of taught to teach your average student. And I didn't get a lot of like sort of your special education training or how do you teach students who have ADHD or students who are autistic or students who, have abuse in their households. We just have so many different kinds of students, don't we? And this year I'm teaching grade 5 online. And that's just, again, there's so much like, oh, one of my little guys, he asks questions all the time. And so the other day I told him he could ask 10 more questions. There was maybe 2 hours left in the day. I think he got to eight questions. You know, I'm pretty sure he deals with a bit of ADHD. And he takes my teasing very well. So, but what do we do with all these different students? How do we teach them all? So I'm just going to go over a couple today that I go over in the book. So behavioral challenges. I think teachers have a lot of trouble sometimes with students with behavioral challenges. When I do workshops, I hear quite a bit of talk about that and questions about that. And so we're going to see maybe what are our students experiencing. So we're going to look at the characteristics where they're easily angered, they're frustrated, they overreact to problems, and they can get violent. So this is what's going to happen. You are all at the same time going to tell me a story about when you got angry. Obviously, I'm not going to be able to hear you. We're going to do it for a minute. And I'm going to set limits on how you can tell the story, not at first, but as we go along. So are you ready? Think of a story of a time you were really angry. Maybe it won't be that hard to think of it. Maybe you'll have to think back of it. Okay. A time when you were really upset. Are you ready? On your mark, get set, and start telling me. Yeah. But I'm glad you're telling the story. Excellent. Yeah. Okay, so now as you're telling the story, can you just talk a little quieter? You're kind of a little loud, just a little quieter as you tell the story. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good. Keep going. Yeah. Okay, so as you're telling the story, please don't use the words angry or frustrated. Okay, so not angry. Keep going. Okay, just go a little slower for me, just a little slower. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay, and that's time. So often when our students with behavioral challenges have something happen that they're upset about, they come and tell us, and we tell them that they're not allowed to swear. Right? In class. And we tell them, you know, that they can't yell it out. Right? So like, we're telling them, you know, like, oh, you have to tell the story about being angry in a certain way. And that's so frustrating for them. right? And if I'm doing this in person, I have people do it in pairs, and I have the other partner tickle with a feather, and then you have to ignore that feather. And the feather represents their anger, right? So when they're telling us the story, even when they're swearing and being loud, they're still ignoring the part of their anger that tells them to hit something, right? Because that's what their anger is telling them, you know? So as we deal with our students with behavioral challenges, if we can sort of remember this, and how did we feel when I said you can't use the word frustrated or angry, right? That really puts a damper on how you're going to tell the story, right? When I'm telling you to be quiet and, right? So maybe we can remember that a little bit. So our next slide. I had a student, she and I got along really well. She was on a safety plan for violent behavior. I taught her for 2 years. The first year I taught her music, and the second year I taught her physical education. And one day in the gym, she just got really upset and started swearing and throwing things. And, you know, I gave her some time out to go, you know, walk it off and come back. And so she wrote me this note the next day. It says, "Dear Miss Yuill," that's not how you spell my name, but I thought it was great phonetical spelling. "I am sorry for misbehaving. I want to behave, but sometimes you get me mad. That is all I have to say. Sorry, heart, heart, XOXOXOXO." I love this note. I still have it. I feel like, oh, good. Even though it wasn't a really great day the day before, it did get a little bit better. And okay, so what are some things we can do when we're dealing with behavioral students? The first thing we can do is to change ourselves. A change of perspective can sometimes help us a lot with behavioral students. So I really like the book by Ross W. Green, Lost and Found, Helping Behaviorally Challenging Students. His main thesis is that we've sort of been taught that when children misbehave, it's because they want to. They want to do those things. But his point is that it's not that they want to do those things, it's that they lack the skills to do what we're asking them to do. And he has quite a bit of research behind this. So after I read that book, when students would, you know, do something that wasn't the best, I would think, oh, they lack the skills to do this. And I found that as I started thinking that way and trying to help them get those skills, that I was less angry at them, because I no longer thought they were wanting to do it. And I started being less angry just inside myself, a lot calmer, and I had better days. And after a while, I thought, I don't even care if this is true or not. This is helping me have better days at school. I'm going to continue thinking like this. And I do think it's true. And so what I've been doing is teaching the kids the skills they lack. So for example, when I taught kindergarten 1 year, one of my students had a hard time coming into the school in the morning after lunch. But I knew that she liked being near the front of the line. So I asked her if she was always second in line, would that help her come in? And she said yes. And that was our very first step in teaching her the skills to come into the school. I also have like tips to help aid compliance. With my students, I ask them when I call their name to respond, "Yes, Miss Yuill." Because I find if they say yes before I ask them to do something, it increases the chances that they will say yes again. And I sometimes joke I'm going to change my name to Miss Yes. Then they would say yes, Miss Yes. And then they've said yes 2 times before I've asked them to do anything. Also, the other thing I do to aid compliance is I get them to agree with me about something. So when one of my students, when I taught grade 7, if they get really angry and, you know, they couldn't sit down because they were so angry about something, you know, I would say something like, "Oh, it looks like you're really having a hard time sitting down, or you're very upset. Is that right?" And then they would say, "Oh, yes, that's right," or "Yeah, that's what's happening." And after they agreed with me, it was much easier to help them to either do what they had to do or to find an alternative. So there's much more in the book about that, but those are just a couple of tips. Okay, the last one we're going to do is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So I am going to be asking you mental math questions, and you are going to move one of your legs back and forth and the other one front and back. I don't think I can even do that with my hands. And then you're going to answer the mental math questions. And even so much better if your children or a spouse at home is asking you questions, because we're looking at being easily distracted, the need to move in a limited sense of time. Okay, so are you ready? I'm going to get my timer going. We're going to do this for 1 minute. Okay, ready? Start moving your legs. Any mark? Get set. Go. Okay. What is 236 plus 260? What is 180 plus 620? What is 240 plus 423? What is 328 plus 310? And that's the time. Okay. So I have a confession to make. That wasn't really a minute. That was only 30 seconds, because students with ADHD always think they have more time. Right? They do. They always think they have more time. And I remember this one little boy. Yeah, it is hard. It's hard, right? Because they have to move to be thinking, right? And they're moving around and perhaps distracting our other students, or online, they're getting up and they're out of their chair and who knows where they are. They're not on camera, right? But they need to be moving to be able to think, just like it's so much easier for us to sit still and think, right? I remember one of my students with ADHD, I had a grade 1-2 class, and I had cups with pencils, and they can just go get a pencil, then put it back, except he always put them in his desk. And so we were always losing pencils. And after a while, the students would go over to him and ask permission to look in his desk and come out with pencils. So I taped his pencil to his desk with this long string. And then his favorite game was to take the pencil on the string and throw it away from himself. And at the end of the string, it would get jerked back towards him. He'd try and catch it. So I never really did come up with a good strategy for him and his pencil. However, we came up with quite a few other strategies that worked well. So one, make organization easy. Okay, so one of the examples I have of this is with grade 7 and 8 students. When they are learning things, they have textbooks. I send a textbook home and they have one at school, because otherwise they take a textbook home one night and they leave it there. And then they come back the next day and they take another textbook home the next night. And all of a sudden I have 2 social studies textbooks left in my class. So if I know I've sent one home and left it with them at home, that really, really helps them. The second thing I want to talk about is their time. Now and not now. So with ADHD, the time is now or it's not now. So if it's now, I'm going to do it now. But if it's not now, I'm not going to do it. And I probably won't do it. That's why we do chunking. Chunking makes each step now, right? Now you do this. And the next day, now you do this. Or the next 5 minutes, now you do this, right? So we want to make sure it's now and not now. And I did want to mention understanding the limits of ADHD. My aunt has ADHD, and she told me her executive functioning is about 20 years behind. So her decision-making, planning, all of that, she figures is 20 years behind. So if my grade 7 students are even 5 years behind, that really changes what I'm going to expect them to do. So there's just so much more. Lots of great resources. There's a handout. Please look it over. Please ask questions. And thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Amanda. I have to tell you, when you started speaking at the start, though, I was going, holy smokes, have I got the wrong place? So that I really enjoyed that. That was great. I was, as you were talking, though, there's something you didn't really mention, but it's kind of captured in the title of your book. When you say reaching and teaching them all, when we use all in education, that's pretty encompassing. And clearly there's a passion there, you know, in talking about this. Did you go into teaching thinking that this was an area you wanted to focus on and support all kids, and especially, you know, kids with, say, ADHD? Or is this it kind of found you over time? Just kind of curious, kind of where it all started.
Yeah, it definitely found me over time, especially because when I started teaching, there wasn't the variety in the mainstream class that there is now.
Right.
And so I started looking for help with different students and thought, you know, you can get this book for this and this book for this and this book for this, but I needed something that was just like, I need to teach them all. Yeah. Something that's not too long, something that's funny. So yeah, that's how I sort of got into that. And of course, over the years, you're like talking with this special education teacher and with this specialist who comes in, and they have such great ideas. And I just started writing them down.
Great. That's really good. Good. Well, thank you very much
and
taking the time today to share your thoughts and passion with us. So thank you. Good. Moving on to our third presenter for this evening. And I'm very pleased to introduce on the camera beside me, Brenda Stein Dzaldov. She is a school administrator who has worked for more than 20 years as a classroom teacher, an educational a consultant, and a teacher mentor. She's an author of numerous children's books and has published many articles on student literacy learning. And I know through her experiences as she was working on her doctoral studies, a huge focus on literacy. And I know that part of today and is going to be capturing in a very brief sort of introduction some of those passions around literacy and meaningful learning. So Brenda, it's great to have you here. Thanks for taking some time to join us, and I'll pass it over to you.
Thank you. So nice to be here. I've been writing for Pembroke for quite a few years. So this is my latest book. And why I wrote this book is because when teachers have an opportunity to inspire students to want to learn, everyone's happier. The kids are happier. As the previous two presenters said, the teachers are happier. And it just is, you can really have a good time in school. So ask questions as I'm going along. We have the chat on. And so how do we inspire meaningful learning in a pandemic? Well, we know we had a steep learning curve as we switched online. I don't think I've ever had a learning curve that steep. Maybe when I had my first child. But other than that, I don't think I've had a learning curve that steep. Getting online, figuring out Zoom, how do I do this? How do I do that? But now it feels pretty comfortable. And over time, as we practice things that are hard, we become more comfortable with them. And what we found is that the principles of engaging students in learning are basically the same, just the tools are a little different. The content might be a little bit. Experienced teachers at the same time. So, teachers work hard. What is a good teacher? What is a good day for a teacher? So I've put a few things in here. Usually I like to like let them go one at a time, but can you write in the chat, what's a good day for you, teachers? Those are both, thank you, Amanda and Heather. Any of the participants also have any ideas? What's a good day? Of course, when students are engaged in listening, when they're smiling, when they're happy, and when they understand the content. But we also are pretty excited when we can meet with small groups to meet their needs. Yeah, students who are eager to learn, they're curious, excited. We can spark curiosity with them. Yeah, and having time to build relationships. So Erica wrote engaging with kids in the hall. Sometimes those are wonderful moments too. We can also do that in the classroom, as Heather mentioned, and of course, as Amanda did. And when students love my lesson, that feels good. Outside is also wonderful. Stephanie, who I've known for many, many, many years and is an expert with outdoor education. So when most teachers think of lesson design, this is what they think of. I can't wait to do lesson plans all weekend long, said no teacher ever. How to write lesson plans. Find your plan book, hear email, check it, eat chocolate, chat with coworkers, surf teaching sites, try again tomorrow. These are the kinds of things that teachers think when they think about lesson planning. So I'm talking about lesson design, which is a form of lesson planning for sure. However, I say, and I will defend this forever, that when you are well planned, classes go well, learning happens, and you will get those things where students love your lesson, where they're curious, where they're engaged. Planning makes a huge difference. So think about a great lesson you taught or observed. And again, I'm going to ask you to use the chat and share what are some of the characteristics of those great lessons. So what got your kids engaged or excited? When did students love your lesson? When did students understand the math lesson? When it's related to the student and who they are. Amanda wrote, it relates to the student's life. Give me a few more. Games, interaction, yes. Kids like to interact. And often the games also make them curious. What's going to happen? What's the answer going to be? How am I going to solve this? It is absolutely okay to use chart paper and markers. We just do it on a virtual whiteboard now, Erica. Real life experiences related to their lives, yes. And on top of those ideas, there are quite a few others, in the book I say six, other elements of a lesson that are going to support students along the way. So we know, of course, that we need to plan. Whether you plan by flipping through educational sites and finding good, you know, sheet like graphic organizers and or planning games, or getting to know your students a little so you can steer the content. I think that really planning is at the heart of meaningful learning. So number one, our relationships with the students we have, and that's come up quite a bit here. The language we use, Amanda was referring also to being aware that how we talk to kids is important. And when Heather was talking about humor, humor is so important, but some teachers are edging towards sarcasm, and sarcasm is not great. So we have to be careful about the language we use, the way we spark curiosity, how we understand the content. You have to know a lot in order to teach. And of course, using a variety of tools, such as games, organizers, activities, different kinds of technology that supports learning. So in my experience, so 22 years in the classroom, 6 years as a principal, and now overlapping all that, I'm not quite 70 yet. Ten years at OISE UT, it all, you know how to teach it, and you have a good relationship with kids. Kids learn a lot more from teachers they love and or like, who are kind, who are compassionate, lots of threads going through the three different speakers, and that can result in meaningful learning. So what I've done is I've taken a lesson design that many of you may have learned about in Teachers College, they're still teaching it, and I've adapted it, and I've made it simple. So when we think about bringing students into the classroom and a particular lesson or series of lessons, we think about how we're going to welcome them into learning. Research shows that some students go through the whole day without the teacher looking them in the eye, meaning they line up outside in regular times. They come in, they're put in groups. Their teacher never doesn't say their name unless they're calling attendance, and they move through the day without that personal connection. So the very first thing is personal connection. The next thing is hook them into learning. Do something fun, like show a video, an interesting picture, a problem to solve, etc. The lesson that I have in the book shows you many, many, many options. Then you got to tell kids what they're learning and what they need to know and do to be successful. We like to know that too as adults. Then you're going to teach them something. We don't want to miss that part. We're going to teach them something, and then we're going to show them something about how to do a task or activity. Then we're going to have them practice on their own, in small groups, with us, in various different ways. And then we're going to see if what we think we are teaching is what they are learning. And then we're going to close the lesson. So closing the lesson is not just going to be see you tomorrow. It's going to be a few moments of time where we wrap up the learning and check in to make sure that learning happens. And yes, Stephanie, co-constructing success criteria is a very important part. And I'd say, like, first start with sharing the success criteria. And then when you get good at it, you can co-construct with the kids. So the lesson design is in the book. And basically what I've done is I've taken those six elements and I've given many, many ideas for what you could do for those various elements and spaces to write down, check boxes, circle, highlight, etc., so that you can go through and think. You don't have to do it all, but to think through a lesson from beginning to end so that you're not sort of missing any of the areas all the way to closure. So I have a sampler for you that Lionel's going to share. And in the sampler, the front of the sampler is my book cover, and then the lesson design for meaningful learning, and then some other samples from the book that help you implement the lesson design. So self-assessment forms, so students will know, show what they're learning, ways to do small group teaching, types of feedback that you might give to kids along the way when you're checking for understanding. So each of the six elements is set up in the book to give you lots and lots and lots of ideas on how you might want to do it. So I think the sampler's coming probably in the chat. And I'm just going to move on here to talk a little bit about an inspired lesson from last week. So one of my teacher candidates was teaching online through Zoom, which I know a lot of you are, using Zoom and Google Slides, and use the lesson design for meaningful learning. It was the one that he chose. We gave them lots and lots of options, and he was able to go through step by step and plan all the areas of the lesson. It was a two-day piece. And he was very, very successful. And he told me, his name was Paul Kumal. I would give him credit for sharing his lesson here. He told me that understanding how children learn and meeting those needs and requirements during the lesson and the ability to think that through was the reason that those lessons were successful. Kids really love them. They didn't even want to get off Zoom. So it's very interesting to me, because I've seen it over and over again, that when we really think about the steps that inspire meaningful learning, where we value students' interest, where we spark curiosity, where we check in with them for understanding meaningfully, where we plan for small groups and one-on-one because some kids need it, then what we get usually is very engaged students and teachers. So I will also have Lionel share that lesson, because you may be interested to see a lesson in practice. So the book supports really many, many aspects of teaching and learning. So I was mentioning, for example, checks for understanding. Here are three kinds of feedback: motivational, evaluative, and descriptive. Probably most experienced teachers have heard a lot about giving descriptive feedback, which is in relation to the goal and success criteria: specific, timely, authentic, etc. But evaluative feedback is also important, and so is motivational feedback. So this is the kind of thing you'll find in the book, is ideas around, you know, the difference.
Brenda, thank you very much for your session. And I really wanted to ask you a question about planning. So we're going to have to figure out another session to have you back. But thanks to everyone for joining us tonight. It was great to have you here. And have a great holiday break. And we look forward to seeing you again for our sessions in the new year. We will send out emails to everyone that's joined us so that you know our plans as we move forward. And as a reminder, the recording link will come out and we will make sure that you have access to this recording as well too. So thanks everyone. Have a good evening and we'll see you soon. Take care.